As it is today, the aircraft manufacturing industry is dominated by two major players. You got the American player Boeing and the European player Airbus. The two companies have been duking it out for decades while fighting off new market entrants. One of those new entrants is Commercial Aircraft Corporation of China, or COMAC. It is a Chinese state-owned company trying to challenge Boeing and Airbus in the commercial aircraft space. It represents China's most considered effort for this market yet. In this video, I want to trace China's recent work in breaking into the super competitive commercial aircraft manufacturing industry and why it has been so hard for them to make ground. But first, I want to talk to you a little bit about the email newsletter. I know that there's a lot of videos on this channel, and despite going back many years, much of the content is still quite relevant. This newsletter is to help you get started with some of the best hits. I really enjoyed sharing the letters on TSMC as well as the one on Foxconn. All great reads. You can find the link to the newsletter in the video description below, or you can just go to asianometry.com. You can expect a new newsletter every 4 days at 1 a.m. Taiwan time. Much thanks. China has always been interested in developing a viable commercial aircraft industry. But early on after the country's founding, it mostly focused on developing military aircraft. Their most common technique would be to acquire a Soviet aircraft and try to backwards engineer an indigenous version. This did not yield much success. The most prominent indigenous commercial aircraft program before the economic reform era was the Chinese Y-10, launched by Mao Zedong in 1970. This aircraft looks like a reverse-engineered Boeing 707. That is because it largely was. The original plan for the plane was to model it after the H-6 bomber, a Chinese imitation of the Soviet Tu-16. But in December 1971, a Pakistani-owned Boeing 707 crashed in Xinjiang, and the Chinese called it a gift from God. Now they had a chance to reverse-engineer what was then one of the most advanced aircraft in the world. 500 engineers were sent to the crash site to study the wreckage for the Y-10. This turned out to be exceptionally difficult. Just because an example plane crashed into your backyard does not magically mean that you can make a plane now. The Y-10 needed 435 parts, and 305 had never been before manufactured in China. For example, the aluminum alloy. Never done before in China, and when engineers tried, the resulting alloy was too heavy and so burned excess fuel. The resulting plane was too heavy, too noisy, and fuel inefficient. It could only fly for an hour before needing to refuel. To test a plane's structural integrity, you need to put it into a wind tunnel, but no such wind tunnel existed in China that was large enough to accommodate it. Thus, it could not be certified for safety, and so no Chinese party official dared to fly in it. The Y-10 was discontinued in 1985, as China was granted a license to manufacture the MD-80, and it shifted resources to do that. Boeing would eventually nix that partnership, though, after its merger with McDonnell Douglas. A few years later, in 1993, China's aviation industry was restructured to create Aviation Industry of China, or AVIC. AVIC is the central state-owned giant of China's aviation industry. It, or its joint venture subsidiaries, have built all the components that go into China's military planes today. The initial goal in creating AVIC was to improve the technology and sophistication of the planes being provided to the PLA Air Force. This goal was not achieved. The PLAAF still declined to purchase AVIC's planes and opted to import from Russia throughout the 1990s. In 1999, the government thus tried to spur new competition in the industry by splitting AVIC into two, AVIC 1 and AVIC 2. The former would focus on military and medium-sized aircraft, the latter transport aircraft and helicopters. In 2002, one of those two companies, AVIC 1, launched the ARJ-21 program. ARJ stands for Advanced Regional Jet, and it was a key part of the government's five-year plan. Regional jets like the ARJ-21 are designed for short flights of less than 3 hours and sit around 100 passengers or less. The dominant player in this part of the market is Brazilian company Embraer. The plane was marketed as China's most comprehensive domestic air flight product yet, an independent design with indigenous intellectual property. Despite this claim, all of its main technologies came from the West. Some 19 European and American contractors provided 70% of the ARJ-21's components. Furthermore, more than a few observers noted the plane's close similarity to the MD-80. Regardless, the plane was heavily delayed after its 2002 announcement, The maiden flight was scheduled for 2005, with commercial service sometime happening in 2007. But the first production aircraft would not fly until 2014, nearly 8 years behind schedule. As of 2020, there are 41 ARJ-21 aircraft in service, all in China. Regional jets are a niche market in China, as they directly compete with high-speed rail. And without extensive marketing muscle, the ARJ will not sell in meaningful numbers abroad, or I guess at all. The Chinese probably learned a lot, but the plane itself is unlikely to ever be a commercial success. With the AVIC split failing to achieve its goals, the government remerged the two in 2008. COMAC was spun off from AVIC and given charge of the ARJ-21 program. There are a few reasons for this spinoff. First, the government felt that foreign technology partners would feel more comfortable dealing with an exclusively commercial aircraft manufacturer. Of course, this fooled nobody, as AVIC remained a critical Tier 1 supplier, and the single biggest shareholder. Secondly, the government had noticed that China's space program was seeing a lot more success after similarly being spun off on its own. Since AVIC was currently bogged down in delays and little progress had been made, the government felt that a new approach was needed. Now, I want to take a brief step aside and talk a bit about the dynamics of the commercial aircraft industry, with special focus on how it works in China. The commercial aircraft industry is big and expensive. It requires large upfront capital investment, as the costs of developing a new plane are high. The Boeing 777 and Airbus 380 planes cost about $6 to $12 billion to develop. Without existing revenues, government-backed funding is required. Furthermore, the two large incumbents hold advantages independent of capital and prices. Aircraft are extremely complicated. Airbus and Boeing are where they are today due to the experiences and mistakes built over the span of 50 plus years. Experience beyond just documented technical knowledge, but also unspoken know-how in how to put these systems together and integrate them at scale. System integration at the highest level. The intense competition between these two well-funded incumbents forced them to constantly innovate on their product and processes. Suppliers are constantly pushed to do better. Each time Airbus loses a deal to Boeing, and vice versa, the loser has to reflect on how they came up short and find a way to compensate. So it can get very easy for a third wheel to get left behind. Lastly, aircraft manufacturers need to really know the legal side of the business as well. Each plane has to be certified by their respective governments as being fit to fly. Adhering to local regulations in both the US and Europe is harder than it seems and remains a significant barrier of entry for potential upstarts. In China, airliners purchase aircraft through the government. They need government approval before such aircraft can be purchased. Western aircraft makers, before being allowed to sell in China, need to set up some sort of technology program in which they have to train and oversee Chinese workers. In other words, technology transfer. This has been going on for a long time, but as I said earlier, succeeding in commercial aircraft is more than about having designs for technology. China's domestic aviation market is the second largest in the world after the United States. So the goal of developing a viable champion in the commercial aircraft market is more than just about national pride. There is also potentially a lot of money in play. So COMAC marched on. The C919 would be COMAC's second craft, first announced in 2008. With the ARJ program successfully showing that China can build products in line with its aviation goals, eventually, the C919 would show that it can develop and build a viable single-aisle 150 to 190 seat alternative to Boeing and Airbus. The plane's product strategy was to reduce fuel consumption by 15% over that of existing models in the market. That would make the plane cheaper to own and run by some 10 to 12%. This would be achieved through the use of composite materials, knowledge of which China acquired after several years working with Airbus' sister company, Eurocopter. Furthermore, the plane would also offer more comfortable passenger seating, more overhead storage, and spacious cabins. COMAC did not have significant revenues at the time and needed to draw on government funding and orders from the domestic market. When launched, COMAC drew on $3 billion of paid-in capital from shareholders and $4 billion in loans from state banks. The Shanghai municipal government provided guarantees for additional loans. Altogether, the planned budget started out at some $10 billion. When launched, it was announced that the plane would take its maiden flight in 2016. To meet this ambitious date, COMAC signed deals with foreign Tier 1 suppliers for many of the plane's critical components. As with the ARJ-21, the plane will be 70% foreign-made, but those suppliers, like I said, need to establish joint ventures with a Chinese domestic player. Foreign companies have implemented certain countermeasures against the very real threat of copying. For example, they might split up the knowledge so that no one Chinese employee knows everything, or manufacture some key component, like the jet turbine blades, outside of China. Nothing is foolproof, of course, but most companies balance the upside with the risk of losing their intellectual property. As of this writing, the program is 4 years late on delivery to its domestic customers. The total development budget is estimated to have ballooned from the original $10 billion to about $33 billion, and that is an estimate I dug up from 2015, so it might be higher today. Higher budgets raise the number of planes that COMAC has to sell in order to recoup its costs, assuming that prices remain the same. Depending on what you assume those prices to be, that totals out to be around 500 or so planes. COMAC has over 300 firm orders waiting on delivery for their C919s, as well as another 700 commitments. Almost all of these are from domestic airliners, with the sole foreign buyer, GE, looking to lease them for the Chinese market. It is not clear when the plane would be ready to challenge the duopoly internationally. The marketing, sales, and customer service departments would need to bulk up and adjust to cultural differences. Chinese banks have offered loans to foreign governments to encourage purchases of the C919, but with little success. Airbus and Boeing can procure loans too. Furthermore, the C919's long delays have had consequences in the larger product market. When announced, it had advances seen by the market as being quite competitive with the competition. But as the delay stretched into years, the plane now faces a different competitive landscape. It now faces the Airbus 320neo family and the 737 MAX, two of the best-selling planes in the world, groundings notwithstanding, with the MAX having some 3,333 orders outstanding as of November 2020, and the 320neo already selling some 7,000 as of January 2021. Those two planes are about 10 to 15 years ahead of the C919, with greater range and lower overall cost of ownership. This lead grows the longer the C919 is delayed. Delays in airplane development aren't uncommon. This stuff is hard. The Boeing 787 was delayed about 3 years as the plane went through quality control issues, and then even after that, the plane had battery problems, which forced it to be grounded for several months. The key challenge for COMAC has been getting the management and system integration right. Like I mentioned above, Airbus and Boeing have moved to where their job is to integrate different systems from different suppliers together in a harmonious way. Project management is a real skill, one that COMAC and its subsidiaries are having trouble mastering. Lack of communication between COMAC's network of suppliers can lead to them working on their own and producing a part that is incompatible with the greater aircraft. Previously, members of the design, research, and manufacturing teams did not work closely together. They worked in silos, doing just their individual part and nothing else. Hierarchical attitudes in state-owned companies also discouraged any questioning of the superior's decision, burying issues until they became more serious. Add to that persistent, cascading quality issues and you can start to see why delays happen. COMAC has hired Western consultants to install best practices, but doing is way different from learning. These are young teams, most under the age of 30, taking on this fantastically hard thing for the first time. It is going to take some effort, money, and experience. A lot of people have pointed to China's high-speed rail industry as an example for COMAC to follow. China has more high-speed rail than any other country and leads the world in rail technologies. It very rapidly developed its own indigenous capacity after technology transfer agreements with Western companies like Bombardier. This is a legitimate success story that Chinese should be proud of. But the dynamics of this market are not quite the same. They might seem to be, since both markets are highly regulated, need boatloads of capital investment, and are cool technology things. But in high-speed rail, the main and sole buyer is the government. The government sets the spec, selects the winning bidders, and is the sole user. It is able to dictate the market. In the world of commercial aircraft, sure, the government appoints and broadly sets the direction of airliner senior management. But the airliners also have to run a business, a really difficult one, and get passengers. No profit-making airliner is going to be a patriot and buy local if the product is terrible. They will lose customers to their competitors, which is going to get them fired. And as for passengers, well, did you see Americans jumping into a Boeing 737 MAX because America? Passengers have too many options today not to get on a plane that they don't believe will be safe. But it also has to be super cheap. But it also has to have amazing legroom, and so on. Customers are demanding. So this is the greater challenge. The product has to be good enough to compete in a competitive market. There are no blue oceans here. Even without the delays, the ARJ21 and C919 aircraft lag the rest of the market, a market that is already constantly innovating. You need to run twice as fast as a running deer in order to catch up to it, unless the deer stumbles. With that being said, the Chinese government seems hell-bent to get there, and I think their strategy development is on the right track. People make too much of the fact that the C919 and ARJ21's components come from foreign-owned companies. The Chinese clearly know that and don't care. Their goal is to master what Boeing and Airbus are good at: the management, coordination, and system integration skills. That is the secret sauce. As I said before, it took those two incumbents over 50 years to get there. COMAC and AVIC have been around for around 20. More time is needed before passing judgment. Thanks for watching. That's it for now. If you want more content, feel free to hit up the email newsletter and sign up. Again, it's at asianometry.com. If you want to drop in line and say hello, then you can email me too at john@asianometry.com. I will try to get back to you as soon as I can. I read everything. So until next time, I'll see you guys later.